Hello everyone and a very good evening to you wherever you're watching in the world. Thank you so much for joining us for the Ferrari Hublot Esports series. This is of course Ferrari's first official esports series and we're getting towards the business end of this competition. We are in our final round of the Pro and Am series before we head into the finals, and it's really exciting because this week we are racing at the world famous Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps. What a race it's going to be. Very excited because alongside me, we've got Paul Jeffrey back in the studio. Paul, this is so exciting. I mean, Eau Rouge and Radiant, that is probably the most famous piece of track in the whole world, right?
Oh, yeah. Show a photograph of that section of corners to anybody. And, well, okay, a lot of people, not everybody. And they will know immediately what you're talking about. It's a brilliant venue to watch. It's a brilliant venue to drive. Producers, great racing. I say it every time, and it's... Try not to be too over enthusiastic all the time, but I am super excited about this one. Great place to go motor racing. Cannot wait
to see how the drivers get on. And also, of course, because we are getting towards the business end of this series, and there is a pretty awesome prize at stake, isn't there?
Oh, yeah, there is. I mean, I can't believe we're at this point already. It's gone so fast, and the championship has been exceptional. To remind everybody at home, it was super easy to get involved. The drivers got registered at the Ferrari website. They got the car. They set the time on the leaderboard. They came and joined us in this series for a series of knockout races and the championship races as well. And they are racing for something rather spectacular indeed, to be part of the same esport team that the F1 World Championship eSport Champion drives for, David Tenitzer, alongside Enzo Benito, to represent Ferrari. And Nicky, it's just like it's literally money can't buy. It's incredible, isn't it?
It is. I mean, a huge, huge privilege to, you know, be part of such a prestigious team. I mean, to be associated at any level, you know, with Ferrari is amazing. I feel it's pretty amazing just being able to wear these shirts. Yeah, exactly. So I can't imagine how the drivers are feeling about all of this. But of course, just a reminder, because after today, it is the top 12 from the AM series and the top 12 from the Pro series that combine together and go into the grand final. So there will be 24 drivers in that grand final. It's going to be an intense end, but of course there is still lots to play for today. And the fact that we are racing in Spa only means it's going to be very, very exciting. And of course, not only are they Spa, they are in the world famous and probably the most challenging car in the world. And that is, of course, the Ferrari 488 Challenge Evo, which has been specially designed for use within the series by the original creators of Assetto Corsa. And speaking of which, we've got a rather special guest here with us today, haven't we?
We have indeed. We've got Marco Massaruto from Kunos. Marco, ciao. Great to have you with us.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
Brilliant to have you here. And Marco, if I may, I just want to talk a little bit about Assetto Corsa and Kunos. All those years ago, when you first developed Assetto Corsa, did you ever imagine that the software would be used in the official Ferrari eSport Championship in 2020?
Well, at the time, I would not imagine to be still alive. So it's been a really a very long journey, and hopefully our aim was to work with the car manufacturers. That's the reason why we created a genuine racing simulation. But being chosen by a very known brand like Ferrari, as Italian, not only as Italian, is just great.
Yeah, it's been an incredible opportunity, an incredible series so far. And some of the driving that we've seen on track has been exceptional from these eSport, both the Pro and the AMs. Have you been impressed with the level of competition and quality so far this season?
Well, I am so glad that Assetto Corsa, Assetto Corsa 1 is still one of the best choices for sim racing even today. I'm impressed as I was years ago, because I'm a bit more surprised about the reaction of the media about that are surprised about the level of the competition and of the competitors, because they are very, very good. We saw last winter or last summer that many of them that raced in the virtual scenario and then they come on the real track and they were very, very good as well. So it's always great to see that these are talented people use our simulation, but I'm not that surprised.
And Mark, I've got to ask, talking of talented people, we've actually got three very talented female sim racers taking part in this series. You know, are you starting to see a lot more women and actually just generally a much more diverse participation moving into esports? And what are your kind of thoughts on that?
Well, it's something new, definitely. But we saw just last year that a lot of influencers, also for the real motorsport and automotive, they came up. So even on this side, I'm glad to see that also a lot of girls and women are joining this kind of sim racing experience. That means that it's not boring, because otherwise we will not see her then. So it's great, and I see that I like also their approach, because they start with a more low profile. I mean, males, we are used to think about ourselves that we are all Hamilton or Schumacher. And I think that the girls have a very different and more professional approach sometimes. So they are absolutely welcome.
More professional, smarter, just all round much better, I'd say. but I'm perhaps a bit biased. Marco, thank you so much. And, you know, thank you again for making all of this possible. It's been awesome to be seeing these guys in the beautiful Ferrari 488.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, on track in Spa. Thanks so much. Take care.
Thanks, Marco.
Bye.
Take care.
Ciao.
So now it's time to remind ourselves of what went on last week at the races at the Nürburgring.
We will find out in a few seconds' time as the red lights go off the screen. The cars are all the way down into T1. Arnaud Lacombe in first position from Kamil Bavlovsky in second. Tucked in right behind is Gianni Di Salvo in the red Ferrari, trying to find a way past as Lacombe goes defensive into the arena. Bavlovsky looks to the outside, opens himself up to an overtake from Di Salvo. Di Salvo on the outside line. That is not the optimal position to be at this stage in the racetrack. Will he try and nip back up the inside of the Polish driver? No, he will not. Pawlowski is aware of what is happening and defends in the black Ferrari. This opportunity to try and make a bit of a gap as we're looking further back now at Samir Ibrahimi on the outside. A little bit of contact there with James Parker. Ibrahimi pushed out wide. He's on the inside for the chicane. The tanks of fuel are full. The tyres are doing it. As we see now, down the inside is Ciclari showing the nose of his nicely coloured, actually, blue Ferrari. Ciclari on park. A little bit of contact coming into the second part of the arena. Ciclari tries to get back up the inside. Instead, he runs wide onto the AstroTurf. That opens the door. Room for two wide through that corner. But he's got a great run on corner exits. Ciclari now behind Parker. James Parker goes defensive into the first part of the chicane. That's going to compromise him on corner exit. Ciclari, wow, what an amazing move to go to the inside into the right-hander. There's no room there. Parker manages to keep the car on the straight and narrow, but Ciclari taking a massive chance. I've never seen an overtaking manoeuvre for all three racers this season. Actually, now we're going back to interrupt myself. Alex Serrato under pressure further back. There's been a change in position. I think, I'm not sure, Simeone seventh. Chris Hockey in fifth position. He's got a car on his outside. That is Serrato on the outside. The outside will become the inside for the next turn. If he can stay with it, Hockey will push him onto the... No, he doesn't. He's very respectful. Actually gives him enough racing room. Simeone looking one way, looking the other, getting the car sideways on acceleration, manages to keep it pointing in the right direction. Intensity level, gas mark 9. This is getting exciting. The same environment that those stars of the future are driving in. And now we're seeing Samuel Ratz around the outside. That becomes the inside for the left-hander. And Samuel Ratz makes an a sterling overtake on Samir Ibrahimi behind. Ibrahimi runs a little bit wide onto the dirt. That will compromise him down this ultra-long back straight before the chicane that has been beyond dominant. This is Arnaud Lacombe round the final corner for the very last time of the third round of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series Pro Championship. Arnaud Lacombe, three races, three race victories, never once looking like he's going to be challenged. A phenomenal performance. Kamil Pawlowski in second, Giovanni Di Salvo. There, revs. The lights are about to go out and we are away. It is a good start at the front of the field from Jarno Kocs in the white Ferrari. Gilioli gets a terrible start in second position and starts to fall down the running order as the field streams by into T1. We've got a late breaker further in the middle of the pack. The cars condense together. Gilioli is in fourth position, dropping two positions from his starting place. Jarno Kocs at the head of the field takes an early race lead. Dominic Blajar in second. DeMalco, who we spoke to at the top of the show, now running 20th position. But look here, this is Morvai on the charge. He's trying, he finds a little bit too much acceleration out of the chicane, makes contact, I think, from Romagnoli ahead, but both cars survive the contact. More measured, it's all smooth, economy of movement on the wheel. Gilioli looks to the outside in T1, a little bit of a rub at the side of DeMalco. The outside of T1 will become the inside of T2 if he can keep his car alongside. No, he cannot, but DeMalco runs a little bit wide. Gilioli forces the issue. He's got his nose up the inside. DeMalco goes defensive. Gilioli tries to do the switchback, goes to the outside, to the inside again to get the run through the complex. On the run down into the chicane, he's got the overlap, but he hasn't got a braking opportunity. DeMalco goes, covering Gilioli on the outside again. Perfect manoeuvre there, not quite enough of an overlap to get the second part.
As it is to D'Alcamo, he really needs these points to secure himself a position in the final.
Oh, Gilioli shows his nose up the inside, makes contact. D'Alcamo manages to keep the car facing the right direction. Now Gilioli under pressure from Blajar behind, but that was a, let's be generous and say optimistic, move from Gianfranco. Gilioli is really, really good on the brakes. We saw it last lap down into T1. I think he maybe got caught out a little bit by D'Alcamo's braking spot. Had no choice but to commit to the move, save smashing into the back of the Ferrari.
D'Alcamo, he doesn't want to be giving this up. He doesn't want to be making mistakes. He, you know, whether it's a second or a third position, ooh, those points are going to be really valuable. Ah, who is that? Numenatali.
Oh, ooh, that's such that? A shame. Yeah. Numenatali spins out of the final points paying position. Too much inside curb into T1. The rear end rotates. There's nothing you can do to catch it because the car essentially is in the air and you cannot opposite lock fresh air. And Numenatali goes from 10th place a little bit loose into the chicane. That sort of slowed him down on corner exit. He knows it out as well. He's gone defensive. Gilioli looks to the outside, brakes on the AstroTurf as well. Makes contact with the side of the second place. Malco ahead of him again gets away with it, but that is more luck than anything else, I'm afraid. Light contact. Will that be the end of his charge? He's got a good run coming into the chicane on the very last lap. This is the final opportunity. It's an incredibly difficult place to overtake. He decides against it, stays behind the car. Can he get a run? He runs understeer through the chicane. That puts him under pressure from Blajar. Dominic Blajar finds one way, then the other. Gilioli covers the inside line. Blajar goes to the outside line, but Gianfranco Gilioli manages to hold it together. Jarno Kocs takes the race victory. DeMalco in second place. Gianfranco Gilioli at the absolute death. And that was two fantastic races, Nicky, from the Nürburgring last time out. Thoroughly enjoyed both the Pro and the Am. Again, fabulous driving.
Yeah, it really was. I mean, Jarno Kocs, he just seems completely untouchable. He is so dominant in this series. It's going to be interesting to see how he gets on today.
Yes, he is. Jarno Kocs is the championship leader. Let's have a look at the AM standings now and see how the drivers line up. Jarno running away from things at the front of the field, but further down the order, it's really, really close for that qualification spot, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think if we look down from kind of anything from 10th, 11th, 12th, there's really just a couple of points between it. So I think, you know, seeing how these guys do today is going to make or break whether or not they get through to the finals.
It is indeed, because this is final round day at Spa-Francorchamps. And the first race we've got coming is the Pro. So we'll have a quick look at the Pro standings and see who's on the money for a good result. Arnaud Lacombe is dominating, just like Jarno Kocs last time. And again, Nicky, in this one, it's the top 12 is all to play for, again, for that bubble spot.
Yeah, it's going to be really difficult to know who's going to go through to the final. But it's amazing to see the dominance that we've seen at the top, you know. Also, we've had Kamil Palowski as well. He's had a brilliant season so far. Arnaud Lacombe, yeah, pretty untouchable. I'm sure he'll obviously secure himself a spot in the final, but it's going to be interesting to see how he gets on in the big final, the grand final against the AM drivers. Wow, what an incredible caliber of pro players we have in this competition. And now, really excitingly, we've actually got the chance to meet two of them or have a chat with them ahead of the race, at least. So let's see how the preparations are going for Tariq Kamil from Ireland. He is here with us now. Tariq, how are you? How's it going?
Very well, thank you. Going well, you?
Yeah, we're very good. Thank you for asking. We're excited about the race ahead, but I want to know, let's sort of cast our mind back, I suppose, to the beginning of this journey when you were first invited to become part of the Ferrari Hublot Esports competition. What were your first thoughts?
I couldn't believe it, really, to be honest. It was a surprise. You know, I wasn't, I knew that there was a lot of high caliber drivers out there, but when I got the invitation to join such a prestigious series as the Ferrari Hublot Esports series, I'm a long time Ferrari fan. And, to be part of something as historic as this, with Ferrari's great history in racing, with, you know, legends like, Michael Schumacher, Nigel Mansell. I know Paul's a big fan of Nigel as well, and he wrote for the red team for a while. Gilles Villeneuve, Alain Prost, and then obviously on the technical side, having the likes of John Barnard, Ross Brawn, Luca di Montezemolo, all these, that's just in Formula One as well. Of course, there's great heritage and history in the sports car scene as well. So,
And now the next generation of sim racers, and this could be you with the chance to obviously win the opportunity to join the team. Talk us through how you think things are going when it comes to the racing, because you've got a couple of points on the board, which is brilliant to see, but you're kind of 11th in the standings at the moment, so you're around the elimination zone, because of course it's just the top 12 that go through to the finals. How has preparation been going ahead of today's race, and how do you think you're going to do?
Yeah, well, it's for sure the level of competition is quite high, and I'm not too happy with my current position. I would have liked to be further up or perhaps top of the standings, but that's what I always strive for. There's a bit of pressure going into this last race now to try and perform well, but as much as possible, I try to treat every race in isolation, basically. So I don't really change my preparation process from race to race. And I just focus pretty much almost every race that I do, that it's a, massively critical race, because, I'm aware as well that it's a short championship, being only, the pro championship is only four rounds. So, it's important to cap, every race. So.
Exactly. I know. Well, hopefully today won't be your last race in this competition. We wish you all the best, Tariq. Thank you so much for talking to us. And fingers crossed, we will see you in the finals in November.
Great. Yeah, hope so. I hope so too. And thank you very much for having me. And I look forward to it. It's going to be a good one. I love Spa. So it's going to be a good one.
So do we. Thanks so much, Tariq.
Thanks,
Tariq.
Good luck.
Thanks. Cheers, Paul. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, awesome there to hear from Tariq. Great to hear how he's getting on. And we've got another one of our AM drivers now. We've got Corrado Ciarello, who, just like Tariq, is fighting for a place in that grand final. Corrado, great to have you here. Hey, how are you?
I'm fine.
Brilliant. Now, Corrado, in your bio, you tell us that 2014 was your best year in sim racing. But heading into the last round, you're on the cusp of the grand final with Ferrari. How are you finding it? How exciting is that at the moment?
Yeah, I'm very, very excited to compete for a place in the final. And I hope to reach the goal, even if it will not be easy at all. And racing the final could prove to be really interesting. Also because with the 2 weeks of preparation, I could better know the secret that this car rides, and maybe put myself in a position to be able to play it. So this will be interesting. So I'm very, very excited.
And well, actually, at the moment... Oh, sorry, Nicky, carry
no,
on.
No, you carry on, Paul.
Because at this moment in time, you're right on the bubble. You're on the cusp of making it through to the grand final. You're in 12th place. Have you got a strategy? Have you got a tactic going forward to get the maximum points from Spa today?
Yes. And first of all, I will try to do a good qualification, which I have never been able to do until now. And if I am in good position for the points, I will certainly not take unnecessary risk. So I will do my calculation during the race, and I will I will act accordingly also, because it's the first two races I risked a lot and I found myself penalized. So if I start behind, I will give my all to do what it takes to bring home the result. So it's hard to race in this condition, but I will try. So
sounds like a very sensible plan. I've got a very technical question for you, Corrado. How long did it take you to grow that beard? Because that is an amazing beard.
thank you. I really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Well, hopefully it will bring you some luck in the race. Thank you so much for joining us, and fingers crossed you make it through to the finals in November.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thanks, Corrado. Good luck.
Ciao.
All right, well, we've been talking about how excited we are about racing at Spa-Francorchamps. Let's take a look at the lap overview and see how this incredible track is going to challenge all of these drivers.
Let's look at some of the key corners of this Spa-Francorchamps circuit in more detail. La Source, good overtaking opportunity, avoid danger in the opening laps. Up Eau Rouge into Radion, fast and brave, an important corner to get a good run down the Kemmel Straight, a flat-out section of track where overtaking and slipstreaming is entirely possible. Into Le Com, a very technical piece of racetrack. Driver will have to balance the car and avoid making a mistake, especially here in Bruxelles. An off-camber corner, happy to spit the car into the scenery should you make a mistake. Down through Pour, fourth gear, flat out, the car finally balanced between speed and mistakes. Campus, another incredibly quick, another incredibly delicate piece of the racetrack for the run through Stavelot. Third gear on corner entry, fourth on corner exit, foot flat to the floor through Blanchimont, one of the most challenging and bravery reducing corners of the circuit, into the bus stop chicane, hard on the brakes, great overtaking opportunity, easy to lose or win time at that corner.
All right, well, now it is time to find out how the drivers are going to line up on today's grid. Has Arnaud Lacombe done it again? Is he on pole position? Let's take a look.
Pole position once again falls to Arnaud Lacombe with 2 minutes 21, 598. Karol Pawlowski joins him on the front row of the grid with Gianni Di Salvo and Jesus Cecilia rounding out row two in third and fourth. Corrado Ciarello is fifth with Danilo Santoro in sixth position, a mighty 1 second away from pole position. Giorgio Simeone in seventh with Samuel Ratz in eighth position, 1.2 away from the ultimate pace. Kevin Sicilari is ninth, and rounding out the top 10 is Ireland's Tariq Gamel, 1.286 away from pole. Chris Hawk is in 11th with Jordi Zwyers in 12th position on row 6. In 13th place is the fastest of our female racers, Eleonora Cavion, 1.4 away ahead of the United Kingdom's James Parker. In 14th, Josh Martin lines up in P15th with Alex Tirato a couple of tenths in arrears in 16th place. YouTube's Chris Hay is 17th ahead of Alethea Book in P18th here at Spa-Francorchamps. Matteo Caruso is 19th and South Africa's David Perel in 20th position. On 21st spot is Cesare Penko from Italy. Victoria Thompson is 22nd from Germany. And in 23rd position, we have Samira Brahimi and Roman Monte rounding out the grid for the Pro Series race.
Well, I can't believe it. But for the final time, we head into the last race of the series. So without further ado, let's hit the track and let the action commence.
And this is it. We are at Spa-Francorchamps. We're getting ready for the first race of the evening. The pro drivers are preparing for action. They're lined up on the grid. They're waiting for the race to begin. And Spa-Francorchamps, always a visually stunning location to go racing, as you can see from the pictures on your screen. And Nicky Shields alongside, mate. Nicky, another great race is in store for all, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, it really is. I mean, one of the most world-renowned tracks. Definitely that moment going through Eau Rouge up to Radeon. I cannot wait to see how these drivers do. And doesn't the track look beautiful? I like how we've got the autumnal colours coming through, which really sets the scene. And yeah, it looks like we're off very soon.
We are indeed. The drivers are looking at the timing gantry. They're waiting for these red lights to go green to start the fourth round of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series Pro Race. And it's a great start from Arnaud Lecomte. Once again, our pole position man goes to the outside of the circuit, covers the line into the tight, into the dangerous Lesource hairpin on this opening lap. The field streams through the first corner down to the run into the most famous section of corners in world motorsport. Eau Rouge and Radeon, will they be going too wide? Will they go single file as they try and find their way, pick their line through the corners? Lecomte is leading from Camo Pavlovsky in second place. Giovanni Di Salvo retains his third place starting position as they run down to Lecomte. Everybody trying to use the slipstream, jockey for position on the race course. These are 20 drivers at the absolute top of their game, and they're trying to shuffle their way through the running order. And so far, thankfully, it looks like a very clean start. But Gianni Di Salvo is a man on his tippy toes, looking at the inside of Pavlovsky. Pavlovsky's aware of what's happening. He covers the line, the Polish driver, not one to give up under pressure. And Nicky, yet again, another outstanding start from our drivers.
Oh, brilliant start. That's what we love about these guys. They're so professional. They always bring their A game, and the beauty of it is that the racing is always incredibly tight. Now, we have seen phenomenal performances from Arnaud Lecomte. He's had 3 wins so far in this series, and this is the final race of the series before we go into that grand final. Can he make it a fourth win? Who knows? But I know Giovanni Di Salvo, Kamil Palowski, they're going to be competing up there. They want to show that they can also be the top. They can also be the very best.
Yes, they do. Every single one of these drivers is performing at the highest level. This man, Tariq Gamel, he's somebody we spoke to earlier. He's on the cusp of getting into the finals next month. So Gamel needing a good score, needing a consistent performance. Can't afford to make mistakes, can't afford to get wrapped up in somebody else's incident. And Tariq Gamel currently fighting just in those points-paying positions. He's chasing down Samuel Ratz in the yellow Ferrari ahead. And Tariq Gamel, look at the concentration, look at the focus from the driver. He knows that Spa-Francorchamps is a challenging circuit in the best of circumstances, but with another 18, 19 drivers all fighting for the same piece of tarmac, it's a challenge unlike any other in world motorsport. As we're seeing now, just to interrupt myself for a second, that is Pavlovsky again under pressure from Di Salvo, but that's allowed Corrado Sorello, the man with the most impressive beard in virtual motorsport, to close up into this fight. So Di Salvo, Sorello, Di Salvo, Sicilia and Sorello, should I say, all fighting for the final step on the podium.
Yeah, his beard is definitely worth a mention, I think. A very fine specimen, we got to say. But yeah, the battle has commenced, that's for sure. And it's nice to see lovely dry conditions. I wonder if we're going to see a wet race in this series at all, because so far, I think they've all been dry races. But it's also interesting that, of course, that there isn't too much strategy to play. There is no pit stop required in this racing. It really is a flat-out race to the end, 26 minutes to go. But it's obviously not just about being the fastest. It's about being the smartest, placing your car in the right position, making sure if you need to, you can make those passes stick, and just gaining on your competitors.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Speed is one thing, but race intelligence is incredibly important as well for these eSport drivers. We're looking at Sorello now. He's in sixth position, so he's got Danilo Santoro ahead of him. So Corrado Sorello lost a little bit from the start, trying to make a recovery. And Arnaud Lacombe, meanwhile, is checking out at the front of this field. Arnaud Lacombe is the man, remember, everybody at home, that has scored three perfect scores in the first three races of this series. This is the final round of the mini championship before the grand finale. So Arnaud Lacombe very much guaranteed to make it through into that joint pro and am final in November. This is purely about performance, purely about setting a marker down for his rivals on the track. And he's now got 2 seconds in his back pocket over the chasing Kamil Pawlowski. And Pawlowski doesn't need to think about going forwards. He's on the defensive from Gianni Di Salvo behind as well. So Pawlowski under pressure in the early stages of this race. We go through the tight bus stop chicane once again to start another lap at what looks like an incredible venue so far. And actually, Arnaud Lacombe gets the fastest lap of the race. No surprises there, considering the pace he has in hand. And everybody's been a little bit sedate at the moment. They've been a little bit sensible. We've got one-by-one formation as all the drivers are trying to judge where they are in comparison to their rivals, where they're stronger, where they're weaker, assess where a safe place to make an overtaking manoeuvre on this track will be. Because Nicky, of course, they need the points because they need to be in the right position in the championship to get through to the final. And that's got to be at the forefront of all these drivers' minds.
Absolutely. Bearing in mind it's the top 12 that go through from the pro and the top 12 that go through the amateur, be the final 24 drivers that go through into that grand final. But again, let's talk back about Arnaud Lacombe. You know, we're talking about how many wins he's had so far in this series. When we go into that grand final, there are going to be three races, and it's based on whoever has the most points at the end of those three races. If he can be as consistent as he's been so far in this season, then he could take home another three wins, which would ultimately secure him the prize, which of course is to become the a driver for the Ferrari Driver Academy eSports team. So Arnaud Lacombe could be our overall winner, just looking at his overall performance and consistency that we've seen so far.
Yeah, he's certainly got the pace, he's got the mentality, and he's in a rich vein of form at this moment in time. But as we well know, getting through to the finals is one thing, but performing on the day, achieving the result, putting all the pieces together to get that end result is an entirely different thing. And if he does win this race, and there is 23 minutes to go, so that's not a guarantee by any stretch of the imagination, that will all give him absolutely no benefit or advantage when we get to the finals, because one mistake will undo all that confidence, all that good work. But that is the future. Let's have a look now at Gianni Di Salvo on board, going through Blanchimont, has to come off the throttle a little bit as the car gets unsettled on the curbs. And Di Salvo now pushing hard for Pawlowski. Eonori Cavion, we're looking at this moment in time, currently running in 15th position in the running order, goes to the outside of Alex Turato. There's no space there, but Turato runs a little bit deep into the bus stop chicane. He's compromised on corner exit. Cavion trying to find one way and then the other. She's running in virtual reality once again, so she get a good all-round field of view of what's happening at this beautiful Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps circuit. Watches her braking point nice and tight into the Lesseurs hairpin. Had to have a couple of bites of the cherry there, almost made contact with the inside wall. And for Cavion, that has compromised her for this long uphill run through Eau Rouge and Radeon, and that has allowed Parker. So Parker now in 16th position has got a run coming down the Kemmel Strait into Lacombe. So will Cavion go from the attacker now into the defender on this lap? Cavion covers the inside line. Parker goes with her, goes back to the outside. Cavion on a sub-optimal racing line. She manages to find her breaking point, manages to keep the 488 Challenge Evo in the middle of the racetrack. And Parker needs to redouble his efforts if he's got any opportunity to get past the fastest female racer we've got in this event so far. Great driving from both of them there.
Yeah, really good. And as you mentioned, you know, it's great to have a few females in this race as well. You know, Eleanor Cavillon, and also we've got Alethea Bouk at the back there at the moment. Now, massive credit to her because, you know, she may not be performing at the top, but she's used this series as a huge, huge learning curve. And every week she comes, she puts in an amazing performance, and we can see that improvement there, which just shows that this is a brilliant opportunity for new drivers to be spotted, for new drivers to be discovered, for new drivers to get this experience that's required to compete as a pro sim racing driver, because it's not that easy. It's so competitive. I think over 20,000 entrants tried to compete and want to be part of this Ferrari Hublot Esports series. So, I mean, the fact that she's here today, you know, in P18 at the moment, is still a massive credit to her. And I'm really excited to see, you know, where her future goes in the world of esports. I think she only picked up about a year ago.
Yeah, she's doing great and building, as you say, experience, which is very important. And of course, Alethea has a considerable fan base in the chat for previous races. So if you're watching this broadcast at home and you're cheering for Alethea Bouk, let us know in the comments section. Give us a shout out to encourage Alethea as she's continuing this journey. But Arnaud Lecomte at the front of the field, another fastest lap, 2.8 seconds to the good over Kamil Pavlovski in second position. And Pavlovski only has half a tenth in hand from Gianni Di Salvo behind, and Jesus Cecilia is also close in on that fight, just 1 second in arrears as we're riding on board now with Tarik Gamel. We saw him concentrating on the picture-in-picture screen earlier on. Tarik Gamel has got a very difficult position. He currently sits in the standings in 11th place. He's got 8 points to his name, so he's 2 points ahead of Chiarello in 12th, who's the man on the bubble. Gamel needs this result. He needs these points, but he's seen Samuel Ratz ahead in the yellow Ferrari. Ratz now all over the back of Simeone. These two are going to start slowing each other down. Samuel Ratz goes to the inside, into Brussels, makes contact with Simeone. Simeone facing the wrong way. Ratz again pushes the car in the right direction, and just like that, as we were saying on the live pictures, anything can happen, and it usually does, and Samuel Ratz makes a mistake into Brussels, takes himself and Simeone outside of the points, and that moves our man, Tarik Gamel, up into 7th place. So Samuel Ratz, a very easy mistake to make, a very last of the late breakers down the inside, and on this occasion, unfortunately for the yellow Ferrari, it just doesn't pay off.
I'm really excited for Tarik Gamel at the moment because, you know, we spoke to him. He really wanted to make this race the race where everything came together. He struggled a little bit in the first few rounds, but he's kind of around the he's on the bubble. He may not go through to the grand final if he doesn't finish in the top 12 today. So this is the result that he's really looking for. The question is, can he maintain that track position over the next 18 minutes and, you know, not cave under the pressure? Because we know how, you know, it's really easy to get yourself in this position, but actually staying there is a whole different ballgame.
Yeah, you are 100% right there. Driving is one thing. Driving in competition when the stakes are so high. Remember, everybody at home, this championship has been designed by Ferrari in order to find the next big esport racing talent. This is a competition for the sake of competition, of course it is, and there are prizes to be won, but ultimately this is to get somebody into a career of racing professional esports for the famous, the greatest brand in automotive and racing. That is pressure that you can't understand what that pressure feels like as a driver unless you're in the heart of the fight. And doing this sort of thing in a non-competitive environment or in tested and practice is one thing, but putting everything together on race day, there are no restarts here. You can't come back and have another bite of the cherry. You achieve or you fail, and it's all down to this 30-minute race, and we've only got 17 left on the clock. And that just changed. You freeze up as a driver. I'm sure anybody knows this from any walk of life in any pressurized activity. When the heat is on, you freeze up. Everything becomes more difficult. You have to think of things more. Your tension in your muscles is greater. And overcoming that is one of the most difficult challenges in real or virtual motorsport or any pressured walk of life. very, very impressive from these guys and girls out on the track so far.
Absolutely. And the amount of practice that is required, you know, it's not just a couple of hours and turn up to the race. They are practicing for hours and hours every single day ahead of a race this weekend. So again, you know, and a lot of them, they're not pro drivers, they're managing jobs. Some of them, I think one's a mechanical engineer, another one's an aeronautical engineer. You know, they're all doing different things at the same time, as well as practicing to be in this competition, because ultimately this is what their dream job would be. You know, they would drop everything to become a full-time esports racing driver for Ferrari.
I think anybody would drop everything to become a full-time eSport driver for Ferrari. As Nicky and I have said on the broadcast in previous rounds, just wearing the Ferrari polo shirt with a prancing horse on it, the badge, the emblem that we all come to know and love through our motor race adventures over the years, that's incredibly proud feeling as a broadcaster. So to be representing the brand in a racing capacity is just absolutely other level, as Arno Lacombe once again smashes in a new fastest lap of 2:22.4. Arno Lacombe has this in the bag. He's got everything he needs to take home this race victory. The last one, don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, the last race of the main series before we get to the grand finale. But Samuel Ratz now on the outside into La Source. He leaves the door open. That allows Cavillon manages to get through. She moves her way up the running order. Ratz now trying to fight back again, and does, on the run through La Source. So Samuel Ratz gets a good exit through La Source. But Cavillon all the way painted to the rear of the 488, over the top of Radion, using the curb, unsettling the car. That's actually a little bit compromising for Cavillon, but she will stick in the slipstream like glue to the back as Samuel Ratz. No doubt she'll jink out, just show her nose on the braking area down into Lacombe. Samuel Ratz a little bit conservative on the brakes and with the curb uses. Cavillon much, much more aggressive over the curb, shortening the distance between herself and the Ferrari ahead of her. She's chasing down now, coming into Bruxelles. This is a difficult corner, very easy to run wide, and Samuel Ratz does run wide. Cavillon keeps the tighter line, just misses the back of the yellow Ferrari through the corner with no name. Another very fast one, got to feather the throttle, use the runoff on the exit of the corner, try and get a good run down into the most incredible Fagna corner on the circuit. Double left-hander, carry the speed through the apex. This is going to compromise Cavillon now. The dirty air of the car in front will make the purple Ferrari behind start to pick up a little bit of understeer. By understeer, I mean the car will not turn as much as the instruction the driver is giving it, because it's going through air that is being disturbed by the car ahead. And this is the eternal problem of motor racing in an environment where aerodynamics are in play. The car ahead disturbs the air that it's pushing through, and that means the chasing car has a less smooth, has a less controlled environment to drive in, and that means you can't quite corner as fast as you could do if you were on your own. But you counter that, but you're getting pulled along the straights faster, so in some you win, some you lose, and that is why overtaking's not just as case of getting up behind somebody and slamming the brakes on later. It's a very technical exercise to execute a clean pass.
It is indeed. I'm not quite sure whether it's because it's been a rather dull, rainy Spa 24 hours recently, but I'm really appreciating how beautiful this game looks this week. I think the track here looks absolutely stunning. The colours are amazing. And that 488 Challenge Evo car is just, you know, something else. One thing though I have spotted is there are lots of fans in the audience there. One thing that we're missing from racing this year. So nice to see a few fans standing there to support the drivers today.
It is, they're basking under the virtual sunshine. And as you say, the autumnal colours of the track, really appropriate for this time of year. Spa-Francorchamps is a beautiful venue. Arno Lacombe, we're looking at now, our race leader. He's got it already. Look at Lacombe. Now, focus on the way that he's driving the car. Look at him on the picture-in-picture, how smooth he is, how relaxed he looks, his posture, the way that he's holding onto the wheel nice and gently. He's caressing the car through the corners. He's fully in control of everything he's doing. He's a man that knows he's got all the tools in his armoury to achieve a race victory, to be the fastest driver on the circuit. Everything is composed and controlled. Compare that to some of the other drivers that we've seen who were in the heat of battle, who were fighting further down the running order. They're much more on top of the steering wheel, they're much more stiff, their muscles are more tense, they're more focused. Lecom looks like he's going for a Sunday drive out with the family. Nice and easy and straightforward, and that is the best sign you will get of a man who is completely in control of his own destiny. Fantastic performance. Again, we've said it three times, and I fear we're going to be saying it a fourth. Arnaud Lecom is the man with all the ingredients to go ahead and dominate this series.
Yeah, I mean, looking at that time, he's really pulling away now. I've got a 4-second lead ahead of Pulowski. So, I mean, really, he can sit back and relax. Maybe they're the wrong words to use, but the pressure's definitely off him at the moment.
Yeah, he certainly can't do anything so much as remotely like relaxing at the Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps. It's one of those old school racetracks that will spit you out the second you decide to not give it the respect it deserves. There's very little runoff, high speed corners, maximum velocity turns, one wrong line, one snatch brake, one too deep entry into a corner, and you are heading towards a world of pain. But Giovanni Di Salvo is not worried about that at this moment in time. Giovanni Di Salvo has got the bit between the teeth very fast into the La Source hairpin. Got a good run up the hill through Eau Rouge in the middle of the corner, through Radion at the top. Maximum usage of curbs, getting good speed at corner apex, good speed at corner exit. Giovanni Di Salvo is as close as he's ever been to Kamil Pawlowski ahead. He's firmly in the slipstream of the dark blue Ferrari in front, shows his nose into Lecom. There's no space there. Pawlowski late on the brakes, keeping the car in the middle of the road, not allowing any opportunity for Di Salvo to find a way past. But look how smooth he is on the steering. Gianni Di Salvo has got things under control. He feels he's got more speed than the Ferrari ahead of him. He matches him corner for corner, turn for turn, through Brussels. Again, he'll be a little bit earlier off the throttle. That's massive bravery, actually, to follow the Polish driver so closely through that corner. There's not really an overtaking opportunity here, but he shows his nose up the inside, tries to phase the car ahead into making a mistake, into getting a sub-optimal line through the double left-hander. We're coming into a fast downhill chicane now, so will Di Salvo try and find space on the outside to make it the inside for the second part? No, he will not. He's keeping his powder dry for the flat-out run towards the end of the lap. And into the bus-stop chicane is his next realistic overtaking opportunity. Pawlowski will know this. Kamil Pawlowski will be keeping his car slightly below the ultimate limit, so he's got something left in the locker. But let's see now if Di Salvo can use the slipstream to good effect through this entirely foot flat to the boards, flat out section, a racetrack. Blanchimont, you'll need a little lift through here because it's not quite flat in one of these Ferrari 488 Challenge cars. Has Di Salvo got enough of a run coming into the bus stop chicane? No, he does not. And Pawlowski will be delighted to see that he's fast enough in the parts of the racetrack that matter to keep this challenge behind. Great driving so far from both drivers. Arnaud Lecom, once again, fastest lap of the race. So he's not letting up at the front of the field. And we're looking at Sicilari now chasing down Tarik Gamal. Gamal holding on to seventh position by the skin of his teeth so far. We've got Sicilari behind him. We've got Josh Martin in ninth position, also lurking with intent. Simeone also just behind Josh Martin. So Sicilari and Gamal are in a position now where they need to be cautious, not fight each other too hard, which will bring them into contention for the cars behind. And that will become a two-car fight, turning very quickly into a five-car fight.
Yeah, there's a great little battle heading towards the sort of middle section, isn't it? Sort of mid-grid, again, because they just need to finish in the top 12. They've got to be, I suppose you've got to be in the top 10, really. You've got to be getting points to make sure you can secure yourself to be in the top 12 and go through to the finals. But Arnaud Lecom there still building up that gap, now 4.5 seconds ahead. 4.6 seconds ahead of Kamil Pawlowski. What a phenomenal performance.
Yeah, that's just incredible, Gaps. I mean, we've seen this level of performance from Arnaud Lecomte. It's always a question mark when we come to a new venue. Will it suit the driving style of the driver? Has he put the practice in required to run at the front of the field? Will something unusual and outside of his control prevent him getting a good score? But Arnaud Lecomte seems to have been touching the four-leaf, five-leaf clovers. What is it for good luck, four or five-leaf?
I think it's four.
Four-leaf, thank you. Touching the four-leaf clovers, left, right and centre in this last week to try and find every advantage he can. And it's working to fantastic effect so far. But Tariq Gamel is starting to pull away a little bit from the chasing pack. And now Sakalar is looking like he might be in danger of getting mopped up by the Josh Martin and by the Simeone fight behind. So Tariq Gamel doing everything he needs to do. Remember, Tariq is 11th in the standings so far. So he needs this result. The man behind him, Corrado Cirello, in 12th in the standings, is ahead of him on the track in 6th position. So Gamel has got to score, has got to take these points home, and he'll be well aware of that one and doing everything in his power to pull away in the last 6 minutes. But look here, this is Alex Tirato on Jury's wires. Alex Tirato at the chicane, trying to find some way, trying to find some space to get past. And that was as close as you're going to get without making contact. Fantastic racing from these two.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. And I also love the fact that we've got such a range of drivers from all over the world in this competition. Yeah. I think it's a really brilliant credit to the competition that it's had such a sort of global appeal. And, you know, we've got all sorts from Germany, Italy, Poland, UK, you name it, all competing together in Spa.
Yeah, it's fabulous to see, as you say. Virtual racing, esports, sim racing, call it whatever you will. It's been around for a long time. We've been seeing a bit of a fight going off here. That's Tirato once again trying to find a way past wires. So Tirato trying to move himself up the running order. He's 13th at the moment. He very much wants that 12th position. He's got a little bit of work to do if he's going to close down the top 10 ahead of him. So Alex Tirato knows in his heart of hearts he's got to make this overtake within the remainder of this current lap if he's going to give himself even the slightest chance of closing down the point positions ahead of him. And Tirato showing signs of a man in a hurry, a bit of urgency at the steering wheel, seesawing left and right to try and get the car around this amazing lap as quickly as possible. But just going back to what I was saying, that we live in a day and age now in 2020 where stable internet connections are something that's very much available to a lot of the world. We've got these great racing simulators like Assetto Corsa that we're using today. We've got brands like Ferrari and Hublot involved in these championships, putting on these races that opens up motor racing to the widest possible audience. And I am honoured, proud, pleased, privileged, whatever you want to say, delighted to be involved in our hobby while it's taking, it's making such incredible strides. As Simeone now in 10th position has got a faceful of Scotland's Josh Martin. Simeone looking to the outside, into the bus stop chicane. Martin gives him as little room as he can get away with it. They both inch perfect on the brakes. Simeone has the inside to a degree, makes contact with the left rear quarter of Josh Martin. That puts the Scotsman out wide on corner exit. Martin now on the defensive, coming down into the La Source hairpin. Simeone in the dark blue car on the outside. Martin on the light blue car on the inside. Josh Martin spots his braking zone absolutely beautifully and goes ahead to lead. Simeone still not giving up the fight, thinking about it on the run to Eau Rouge. That would be ill-advised in the extreme. But can Simeone get the run he needs over Radion at the top of the hill? No, he can't. Josh Martin lives to fight just another day under increasing pressure from seemingly everybody behind him.
Lovely, brilliant battle there. And I got to say, so Alex Tirato, who's down in, what, P13 at the moment, I was looking at his sort of form that he filled in when he, you know, applied and registered to be part of this competition. And interestingly, he's actually included a quote from Michael Schumacher, which says, "I've always believed that we should never, never give up and keep fighting even when there's a small, very small chance." So he's probably thinking something like that right now.
Sorry to interrupt you there,
no,
Nikki, but unfortunately, Martin and the chasing car have made contact. Simeone it was. Martin and Simeone make contact through Lacan. That's taken both of those out of the running. So we saw a grand battle through the first turn, up Eau Rouge and Radion. That continued into Lacan. But unfortunately, Simeone and Martin made contact with each other. That's moved both drivers significantly down the running order. Josh Martin, according to the timing screen, is in P11. Oh, he's made contact again. Martin has the rear corner taken away from his 488 Challenge Evo, and Josh Martin's day has gone from what could have been quite useful, thank you very much indeed, to an absolute disaster. Both drivers out of the running order, and again, this just goes to show things can change in an instant, and for those two drivers, that is a disastrous way to end today's racing, and also puts pay to both drivers' chances of qualifying through to the finals. Real crying shame.
Yeah, absolutely. Massive disappointment for them. But, you know, on one side of the coin, commiserations for them, but it's going to be a benefit for a few of the other drivers who've just moved up and gained a few extra points. It's great to see Tarek Gamil still there, holding on to his seventh position. So with just, one or two laps to go, it's looking good for him.
Yeah, it is indeed. That's taken the pressure off Tarek a little bit, actually. He's still under significant from Ciclari in eight. But there's another fight that's progressing quite nicely as we head on to what I think will be the final lap of the race. This has been going on since basically qualifying ended. This is Kamo Pavlovsky in the lead of these two cars. Second position on the try. Gianni Di Salvo has been trying everything short of climbing over the top of the Polish driver to find a way past for P2. Both drivers are well up in the points, both pretty much guaranteed if they finish this race to get through to the grand finale. So this is all about today's race. This is all about the on-track action. Pavlovsky making sure he has got the widest Ferrari 488 Challenge Evo in the history of the world. Gianni Di Salvo trying every single trick in the book and a few more that haven't been thought of yet to find a way past that dark blue Ferrari ahead of him. He's gone wide, he's gone tight, he's flashed the lights, shown his nose at the inside, shown his nose up the outside, but Kamo Pavlovsky is equal and greater to every single one of the challengers from Gianni Di Salvo so far as we head into sector three for the very last lap of this opening round of the Ferrari Hublot Esport Pro Championship this evening, the final race of the Pro Championship before our grand finale. Can Di Salvo get the best run onto the flat out back section? He'll be wishing he had less wing, less aerodynamic downforce that lets him cut through the air faster. He's not got that one. The setups are locked. The gap is too big. As late as he dares on turning through Blanchimont, uses the curb on the outside, but I fear it's too far to make up as we look at our race winner. This is Arnaud Lecomte. Four races, four race victories, unsurpassed at Spa-Francorchamps. He has won everything that has been laid out in front of him. Arnaud Lecomte is the Pro Championship race winner at the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series from the circuit to Spa-Francorchamps. A master performance against a field of very talented drivers.
Wow, absolutely huge win there. Great to see him doing a little performance there down the start-finish straight. Although very serious there is in his domain. I don't think he even managed a little smile there. But still focused on what's happening. But sad though that this is the end of the journey with some of our drivers.
It is indeed. So this is the final race of the Mini 4 race championship for our pros. Arnaud Lecomte, who we've just seen, dominated proceedings in P1. Kamo Pavlovsky chases him home for the podium position ahead of Gianni Di Salvo in third. Danilo Santoro makes fourth position at the flag after a quiet race ahead of Jesus Cecilia in fifth. Rounding out the top six is Corrado Sorello with Ciclari in seventh, Tarik Gamel in eighth, Hock in ninth, and Jordi Swires is the final player in the top 10. We've got Samuel Ratz 11th, Parker 12th, Chris Hay 13th, Josh Martin after all his troubles in P14th, and Alethea Buck rounding out the finishers in 15th place.
awesome race from the Pro Series drivers there. And now it is almost time to see the AM Series in action. But first, let's meet two of the drivers. First up, it is Dominik Plyer, all the way from Poland. Dominik, thank you so much for joining us. How are you finding this whole experience joining the Ferrari Hublot Esports competition?
Hello, everyone.
Hello. Tell us, how are you finding this experience so far?
How I find the experience, yeah?
Yeah.
So, the Ferrari challenge is not my first official competition when I compete. Before that was money, but the most important was in this year, that was official Polish championship named Digital Motorsport, was organized with Polish FIA. I won them and I became the first Polish champion in digital motorsport in Poland.
What an achievement. So, official Polish champion, but now to be part of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series. How's that?
I think I'm doing good job there, but I am not satisfied as much as I want. So, I hope that I will show my pace in the finals.
Yeah, I mean, you're sixth so far in the standings. So, you know, pretty good. Do you think you're confident that you'll go through to the finals?
Yeah, I'm on very good spot to reach to the grand final, but let's wait until the last round.
Yeah.
Then everything will be clear.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Dominik. Brilliant to speak to you, and all the best for today's race.
Good luck. Thank you.
Bye.
That was great to hear from Dominik, and we've got another one of our AM Series drivers. We've got Anjan Amuthan, who's joining us all the way from the UK. Anjan, great to have you with us. How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Yeah, really, really good. Thank you. And you are the only representative of the United Kingdom in the Ferrari Hublot Esport Series. Does it make you proud to represent the country in this great championship?
Yeah, I'm very proud to represent the UK in this Esports Series. And, well, driving as the caliber of drivers that you've seen for the last few months now, it's really challenging, and especially all the nationalities from, I guess, Germany, Venezuela. This is really cool.
Yeah. And you say, as the quality of the drivers, it's been fantastic. We're at the final round of the season. How are you feeling? Do you feel like you've got what it takes to get in there and score big points?
If you've seen where I'm positioned so far on the table, I'm literally at top position. So I'm giving up my all this week. So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because you scored big points in the Nürburgring, but had a rough season up to this point.
Yeah.
How much practice, preparation have you put in for Spa?
Well, I put a lot of preparation for all 4 weeks, to be fair. It's just when you need to make that lap count. I've been rather poor there for the first 2 weeks, or I believe it was Monza and Zandvoort, where if you make one key mistake, which a key mistake here maybe stands for a 10th, you could go down from maybe 7th place down to 15th or 16th. So yeah, I think that's the key area I need to fix on for this final race in Spa.
Oh, it's so hard, isn't it? The competition is just so tough. But good luck for the race, particularly as you're virtually your next door neighbour. You're in Wembley. I'm in Shepherd's Bush. Yeah. Hello. We're just around the corner from each other.
Just open up the window and say hello for you there.
Okay. Exactly. Well, good luck for the rest of the day.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, brilliant. Good luck. Thank you for joining us. And we'll see you on track.
So it's time to head into the starting grid of the AM Series and find out whether it's Jarno Kocs again on the front row. Can he make it on pole position for another time? Let's take a look.
Qualification would go the way of Gianfranco Giglioli in first position ahead of Leonardo Dalco, 1/10 in arrears. Dominik Blégère in third place. Matias Tucevic in fourth position, just 2.5 tenths away from the ultimate pace. Our championship leader, Jarno Kocs, lines up in fifth position ahead of Michael Romagnoli in sixth place. Numa Natale from Italy is seventh. Marcin Swiderek in eighth position. 6/10 away from pole position. Torben Petsch in 9th and rounding out the top 10 will be Marco Pinero, 7/3/7 away from pole. Wojciech Luskovic in 11th place and Andrea Benedetti in 12th place, and in 13th position is Great Britain's Anjan Amuthan ahead of David Petil in 14th. In 15th position, we have Michael Tenitsa ahead of Thomas Baranovic in 16th. Just 1/10 separate those two drivers as Gregor Schill lines up in 17th, and the Netherlands' Maurice Stryker is in 18th position. Norbert Movai is 19th, Alessandro Ottavani in P20, and in 21st position, we have Gianluca Carotti from Italy ahead of Marco Muri in 22nd. In 23rd position, Thomas Sibilia from France, and Jan Nims rounds out the grid in 24th.
So the time is finally here. We're about to head into the last race of the series for the AM drivers. Can't believe it. Dreams could be made or shattered by the end of this race. Good luck to all of our drivers. Thank you to all of them for competing as well. But without further ado, it's time to go racing.
And now it is time for our second and final race of the evening. The AM drivers of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series are taking to the legendary circuit de Spa-Francorchamps for their final 30-minute offering of this four-round series before we head to the grand finale, the exciting grand finale in November. Before we get going, Nikki, though, just want to take this opportunity to thank our drivers for their participation in this series. Not just the guys and girls that have qualified for the races, but the 20,000 participants that have tried to be a part of this brand new esports series for Ferrari.
Yeah, it's been absolutely incredible. Massive thank you to everyone who's got involved and been part of this whole, it's the first time, isn't it? The Ferrari Hublot Esports Series has taken place. And amazing that some people from literally all four corners of the world have all come together to race here. For our final race in the AM Series here at Spa.
Yep, fantastic stuff. And we are about to take into the circuit, the track action for the final race of the AM Championship. The drivers are on the grid. The starting lights are about to flash up on your screen. They will go red, then they will go clear, and the cars will begin the final race of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series from Spa-Francorchamps. Gianfranco Giglioli converts pole position into a lead down into the braking point, into the La Source hairpin. Everybody fans out at the back of the circuit trying to find room, trying to find track position as they work their way up for the beginning of this race. Giglioli leads from DeMalco in second position, and Dominic Blegère is in third place as per qualification. One by one they go through the Eau Rouge. We see a car off in the middle of Eau Rouge. That is a big accident. We've gone on the grass now. One of the cars in the most fastest part of the racetrack gets sideways in Eau Rouge, thankfully manages to avoid being collected by the rest of the field. We fan down now into Le Com for the very first time. DeMalco trying to find a way past the car ahead of him. That's Dominic Blegère in second place. DeMalco now down in a third position. Roman Goli in fourth, watching best seats in the house. Jarno Kocs, we're riding on board. Jarno Kocs is another driver that has shown his skills, that has shown his speed so far in this series, but he'll not be happy. Anchored down in fifth, and he's got the entirety of the field trying to find a way past behind. But dramatic opening few moments of this race, Nikki.
Yeah, you're right. Jarno Kocs is one of the drivers who's going to be kicking himself with his qualifying result. Normally, he's up there on pole position. He's had three wins so far, and he will definitely be looking to make improvements quickly to get into the podium spots.
He will indeed. He's used to running away from these events at the very front of the field. So this will be fascinating to see how Kocs manages to cope with traffic. For the first time we've seen it this season, it's of course won all three of the opening races so far. So Jarno Kocs now is a man under pressure in fifth, as we're riding on board with David Petil in ninth position. Petil trying to find a way past Pinero ahead of him, trying to keep Numa Natale behind in check. Anjana Rutham is also in on this fight a little bit further down the running order in 11th position. Roman Garley now that we're looking at just on the outskirts of the podium positions. Roman Garley had a strong qualification result, is running well in the race so far, and he needs that. He's 8th in the championship so far. He's got a little bit of fresh air between himself and the all-important bubble position at 12th place, but Roman Garley will be looking to secure a very welcome indeed podium position for his best finish, if he holds it for the next 27 minutes anyway, his best position in this championship so far.
Well, if you're going to do your best, this is the day you want to be doing it, because this has all been about improvement, hasn't it? It's been about progression. It's been about making sure that you're scoring enough points to get through to the grand finals. And then, of course, getting through to the grand finals, you've got to show that you can be the best, because there is only one winner, ultimately, in this championship.
There is indeed. And speaking of championships, championship leader Jarno Koch has moved up to P4. So we saw him last time in 5th place. He's managed to dispose of Petsch ahead of him. So Jarno Koch in 4th place. Now we're looking at 9th place, man. This is Anjan Muthan, currently in 9th position. One of the only British driver in this series. And Muthan, we spoke to earlier in the show, very excited about his prospects for this race. If I'm having a quick look in the leaderboard, he's the man on the bubble in 12th position in the championship with 6 points to his name, 4-2 ahead of Michael Tanitsa, who's the man behind Gregor Schill that we're riding on board with now. So Tanitsa will need to clear Schill, will need to clear Muthan as well to give himself a chance of getting through into the grand finale and potentially driving alongside his brother in the Ferrari Driver Academy eSport team. So big chances there for Tanitsa as we're riding on board now with Tuskevich in 6th position chasing down Petsch ahead. We see Panero in the mirror just running a little bit wide. That'll compromise him for the run down this fast section of corners. So Tuskevich has got an opportunity now, a little bit of fresh air behind, to try and work his way further up the running order. We've already seen a little bit of field spread at the front of the field, so the battle very much is for the lower placings inside the top 10 in the early stages of this first race and final race of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series and Championship before we progress through to the grand finales next month.
Yeah, it's going to be really exciting, isn't it? 3 races in those grand finale races, and bringing the Pro and the Am drivers together for the first time. And we've talked about it before, you know, I think Pro and Am makes it feel like we've got professional and amateurs, but that's actually really not the case. They are all in the same kind of caliber. The difference is the Pro drivers were the invited drivers to be here, and the amateur drivers are the guys who have competed and read through the registration process. But it's going to be really, really exciting to see them all on track together.
Yeah, that's right. The amateur drivers may be classified as AMs today, but make no mistake, many of these will become professionals in the not-too-distant future. Now, we've missed it on screen. I'm not quite sure what's happened there, but Dmalko, who was running up the sharp end, is currently a lap behind in 18th, so he's had a little bit of problem, but that we'll worry about that one in a minute, because Numa Natale is the meat in a Ferrari sandwich. He's got Schill in front of him, Tanitsa behind him. Natale runs wide. That opens the door for Michael Tanitsa, who steals in and takes the position. Numa Natale, under pressure, trying to find a way past the car ahead, makes a mistake, and now he's under significant pressure again from Stryker and Benedetti behind. So Numa Natale going backwards. But we spoke about Tanitsa, we spoke about his need to move up the running order. He's 13th at the moment, so Tanitsa has got to get a shuffle on if he wants to be in with a chance of getting the ultimate top 12 position in the running order. And Jarno Koch now, Jarno Koch in the white Ferrari at the back of your shot. He was 5th. We said that he's accustomed to running at the very sharp end of the field, and now he's doing everything within his power to find a way past Roman Garley in 3rd place. He wants this podium, and quite frankly, if the speed that we've seen from him so far this season is anything to go by, he'll still harbour ambitions of closing up on the 2 race leaders, if it's just for the little task, the small issue of getting past Michael Romagnoli ahead for 3rd before he starts making his way up in the next 22 minutes and change.
Now, we've seen already how difficult it is to pass here at this track, but where do you think, Paul, if he's going to make his move, where would you recommend he does it? Where do you think he's going to have the most opportunity?
Well, from Roman Gali's mistake, I think here, Nicky, down the inside. Fantastic timing. That could not have been scheduled. Brilliant stuff. But actually, he ran a little bit wide, did Jarno Kocs. That's allowed Roman Gali to get a good run. Coming out on the source, they're going too wide into Oruge. This is dangerous. This is dangerous. Kocs on the outside, makes a little bit of contact, gets the car sideways, survives that one with nothing short of exceptional reactions. But now Petr's got to run. Coming down the straight into Lecom. Petr, easy overtake there, heading down into Lecom. He's got the run over Roman Gali as well. Going too wide into La Source is only wise if you're walking up the hill, certainly not if you're racing. That is a danger zone, and quite frankly, Jarno Kocs was very, very lucky to get away with that one and still survive in fifth position. Now he's got it all to do, and we can see Tyskiewicz behind closing down as well. So Tyskiewicz wants that position as well. Jarno Kocs will be mad in the cockpit of that 488 challenge. He'll think that that third position was his for the taking, and Petr in the middle will just be shaking his head going, wow, did I really see what I've just seen? How am I fourth? And he'll be looking to find a way ahead of Roman Gali, currently in third place. Great racing from all four of these drivers.
Great racing, but yeah, but pretty close there. Lucky it didn't end in tears for one of those drivers, but good to see that they're all still on track. Again, it just shows though, you know, as soon as you go off the racing line, you lose that grip, and then you are, well, you're basically at the hands of the track rather than in control of your car.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Hope everybody at home, by the way, is enjoying this broadcast. Please do engage in the comments section of wherever it is that you're watching the Ferrari Hublot Esports series. We have got staff members in there. We will answer your questions if you post them. So do come and say hello to us on broadcast and the staff in the comments section. But meanwhile, we're still tooth and nail. Petr a little bit deep into the bus stop chicane, runs a little bit wide at the first part. That compromises him for the second part of the chicane. That will mean he's a little bit slower on the run down into the La Source hairpin. Fortunately for him, this is a short straight. Jarno Kocs can't take advantage, but he's tight through La Source. He tries to get on the power as early as he can. We're going downhill now as we're running into La Source. The driver can see the tarmac ahead. He can't see the corner in front. We're about to go uphill for the left-hander. Use all the curb. Now you're facing Sky. Now you maximise the amount of curb usage at Radeon for the run down the straight into Lecom, one of the best corners on the circuit, in my opinion. A great overtaking opportunity on the outside or the inside. But Petr just has enough leeway ahead of Jarno Kocs to save the need for defending. Kocs has got Tyskiewicz in sixth position and Panero in seventh position now, queuing up to have a go at the back of the championship leader. So he's actually, it feels, Nick, a little bit like Jarno Kocs is going backwards slightly rather than forwards. The gap at the front is getting larger, and Roman Gali can see that in his mirrors, and he'll be moving away with a bit more confidence as Petr, Kocs, Tyskiewicz, Panero, and maybe even David Patil and also Anjan Muthan start to fight over that fourth position.
Yeah, it's interesting. I wonder what's happened to the pace of Jarno Kocs this week. Maybe it's the pressure getting to him. This is what happens, isn't it? You know, when you've got to perform, it's really hard to. It's very difficult to keep the momentum going and just keep delivering top quality performances. But you know, you mentioned there about a couple of overtaking spots. There's also some, I mean, brilliant places. You've spent a lot of time at this track as well, Paul. Where would you say the best places are to watch the race from?
Well, that's got to be Eau Rouge. Got to be Eau Rouge. The velocity, the intensity of these kind of cars on that spectacular piece of racetrack, uphill, over the brow of the hill. You can get so close, you can see the whites of the driver's eye, you can see the minute movements that the car is making as it's balancing on its absolute limit, on its tippy toes, the edge of adhesion that you just can't see on television pictures. The sights, the sounds, the smells, the velocity, the emotion, it's all crystallized in one section of corners. If you're ever going to go motor racing, if you're ever going to stand anywhere in the world to watch racing cars, you stand at Eau Rouge, you step back, you wipe your brow, and you go, wow, that is otherworldly.
I think your body literally shakes with the vibrations of the car going past. You know, I mean, I'm not going to say it live on air, but I definitely used a few explicits when I was standing there.
Yes, I got a text message from you with said explicits.
I was blown away because, you know, you never really get the opportunity to get so close to the cars, but you suddenly appreciate just how fast they're going, and they really are flat out through Eau Rouge and into Radeon, and it's just an incredible spectacle to be able to feel it and take in the atmosphere and really understand how incredible these cars are, how incredible the drivers, and also huge respect for everyone working around the track, you know, the marshals, the cameramen, everyone that's so close to the action. It really is quite an incredible spectacle.
Yeah, it's something, as I say, something otherworldly. And remember, I know we're only doing this virtual in the Ferrari Hublot Esports series, but these guys and girls are on track doing this in the cockpit, but they're doing it at the same time as they've got rivals who are just as fast as they are, trying to steal away that track position, trying to put them under pressure. And that is another facet, again, that the drivers have to deal with. So huge, huge respect to each and every one of our drivers. We're saying about Jarno Koch earlier, we don't know where his pace has gone. That's, put it into perspective for a moment, he's driving lap times still that are multiple seconds faster than the normal people like us could ever wish to achieve in a virtual race car like this one. So although he's not at his usual sharp best, that's Gianfranco Giglioli's responsibility today to walk away at the front of the field. 2.6 advantage he currently holds over Dominic Blégère behind. But Koch is still performing incredibly well, and most importantly, he doesn't need to worry about the win. He's secure in the knowledge that he is mathematically impossible to drop out of the top 12. He will get through to November's final. And the be-all and end-all, as much as you want to win, that's also, that's got to be the eyes on the prize, has got to be that one, hasn't it?
That's a very good point. And then they're going to start off with a clean slate. You're not carrying points through. So it's starting from scratch with those last three races. So actually, yeah, maybe the pressure isn't on today. Maybe I've got it the wrong way around. And he should be sitting back and relaxing and enjoying the racing. But he's a really talented driver at just 19 years old. You know, he's not a professional sim racing driver. He does this as a hobby, realizes that it's a lot of fun, and he's actually obviously quite talented and good at it, and wants to make a career out of it. And again, you know, we've said before, that's why this is such a great platform to discover these young, talented drivers.
Yeah, it is indeed. He's going about it the right way at this moment in time. We're looking at him now. Jarno Koch is the white Ferrari that's second in your shot. Pesch is currently still the cork in the bottle of this train. But Matthias Teschkowicz in the dark blue Ferrari behind is very, very focused on trying to relieve Jarno Koch. We can see picture in picture now, concentrating away. He's trying to relieve Jarno Koch of this fifth position. Teschkowicz has got the most difficult to pronounce surname in the world, but it's also an incredibly talented racing driver. We've not seen as much of him as we would like to do so far this season in terms of his overall ultimate performances, but he's now in a perfect place to start fighting for that top three, top four positions. We go back now to Marcin Swinarich in 11th position. So Swinarich that we see in the number 37 Ferrari, the back of a train of four cars. He's got a Muthan ahead of him, who's got Mironovic ahead of him, and David Patil leading this little train of cars just in and out of the points paying position. So Swinarich is very much a man who's desperate to start moving up in the final 14 minutes of this race. He's got got three cars ahead of him. That will be three times the slipstream effect coming through this part of the racetrack. That's exactly where you need it to be. He will lift a little bit earlier through Blanchimont to give him a good run into the hard stop of the bus stop chicane. Three cars ahead. That will be a little bit of a pendulum effect as the old brake, Swinnerich, later on the brakes than his immediate rivals, closes up to the rear of Amuthan behind. He gets a good run through the bus stop chicane. We've seen passing is entirely possible heading down into the opening hairpin, into La Source. Will Swinnerich decide to do it? Will he keep his powder dry? Yes, he does. Spots his braking zone nice and neat on the throttle. Keep the car rear as planted as you can to get the run into a Rouge, to get the run down the straight and into Le Combe. And this is fantastic racing from these four drivers as they all fight over that eighth position.
Yeah, brilliant to see. Again, it seems to always be the kind of middle of the pack who are bunching up, going head to head, trying to make their move stick. Mainly because, of course, it's when you're on the bubble, you know, you've got to be in the points. You've got to be finishing in the top 10 to secure your place in the grand final. David Patil, he's put up a pretty good show, actually. I've enjoyed watching him and his performance over the past few weeks, and fingers crossed. I mean, he started his career, I think, a couple of years ago with GT Sport. He's raced in iRacing, Assetto Corsa, and is basically here to make a bit of a stand and to say, you know, I want to do this as a long-term career. So again, he's going to be one to watch.
He is indeed not making a mistake, but now we see that Amuthan runs a little bit wide in the corner with no name. That opens the door for Swinnerich up the inside, into the left-hander. Swinnerich gets the rear end, trying to overtake the front, manages to balance the car. Enough space was given by Amuthan, and Swinnerich, Marcian Swinnerich, makes almost an impossible overtaking manoeuvre possible. Great piece of driving, a little bit of paint rubbing, and that all came from a mistake from Anjan Amuthan into the corner with no name. Ran a little bit deep, less traction on the AstroTurf on the outside of the corner. That opened the door for Swinnerich, and Muthan closed the door on the inside, but that was never going to be enough to stop Marcian Swinnerich finding a way past, using all his bravery, using all of his nine lives in one fell swoop to get an outstanding overtaking manoeuvre done. And I've got to admit, that's hairs on the back of the neck moment. Probably a fresh pair of underwear as well for the driver, but a great overtaking manoeuvre.
Brilliant manoeuvre, and just when he needs it, because Marcian Swinnerich is currently 11th in the standings. He's got 8 points. So to obviously secure himself, he needs to get that extra point. So being in 10th position is exactly where he wants to be. Also, I found this quite interesting. He was saying, you know, how we were talking earlier about the AM drivers and the pro drivers. He said he doesn't like being categorized as an AM driver because he realizes that actually there's no gap between us and the pro drivers. It's obviously, as we agreed, it's just the way it's been categorized for this competition, and they all will be together in 2 weeks for that grand final. In fact, make sure you put that date in your diary. It's Friday and Saturday. I think it's the 6th and 7th of November, but it's definitely the Friday and Saturday in 2 weeks' time. So make sure you join us for those.
Yeah, they're going to be some absolutely incredible racing events. So please do come and join us. And as we finish off what has been an exceptional journey with Ferrari, with Hublot, with Assetto Corsa, it's been amazing. We've still got some racing left to do today. We've still got 9 minutes and 45 seconds left on the clock to close out this final of what we'll call the championship races before the grand finale. And Numa Natale fancies his chances of finding a way past finding his way past Michael Tenitsa. We spoke about Tenitsa earlier. He was someone that needed to put points on the board to get through. I'm afraid that's a little bit too big of an ask at this stage in the proceedings, but keep your eye on Tenitsa in future weeks and months. He's a talent that is very much getting into the world of esport racing. I'm sure we will see more from that name as the years progress, but for now, Numa Natale has seen more than than enough of the rear of the 488 Challenge Evo of Michael Tanitzer ahead. And the Tyler getting a little bit ragged now, running a little bit wider into the corners, a little bit more sliding than he would like to be. And when you start getting ragged, when you start losing your composure, your tyres get hotter. When the tyres get hotter, they start to drain. When they drain, they give up less grip. When they give up less grip, you slide some more. When you slide some more, you've got less grip. And so on and so on. So Natale needs to reset himself and the car, needs to compose himself. Otherwise, he's going to become more and more out of control. As he looks down the inside, the bus stop chicane, late on the brakes, too late in fact, over the curves, concedes the position, bounces over the sleeping policeman. And that is exactly what I was talking about. Numa Natale getting a little bit ragged into the closing sections of this race, and he makes a mistake, and Tanitzer now has bought himself a very handy buffer to the car behind, and that'll be relief time for Tanitzer. As we're looking now at Tiskovic, watch him on the onboard camera. As you can see, the control, he's got an unusual steering wheel there where it's a flat or an empty bottom to it, so a bit like a Formula wheel but inverted the other way around. And Tiskovic concentrated, he's got his shorts on, he knows it's going to be pretty hot going with the pressure on, and he's driving a superb race at this moment in time, currently in sixth position. The car ahead is within striking distance, but maybe he's thinking about now consolidating, getting a nice haul of points, and as we said many a time before, let's make a little bit of contact. Tiskovic, a little bit of contact from the car behind. He closes the door again, so doesn't open the door to Pinero, but a little bit of contact into Bruxelles, I think it was, or it might have been just the camera angle. Actually getting excited, Paul, over absolutely nothing there. Never mind, moving on. Nicky.
I've also got to say, I love the broadcast of this as well. You know, the fact that we've managed to get cameras on all of the drivers so we can see their expression, we can see what they're doing, we can see their setup, what simulator they're using, their sort of style of driving as well, I think gives us that extra insight into understanding the driver. And it's brilliant to get to, you know, to be able to get to know them a bit better by having that camera set up. I'm sure at the moment, though, Numa Natale is absolutely kicking himself for letting, for basically braking too late and letting Tanitzer pass, who's now 4 seconds ahead. And that means he's definitely, unfortunately, going to be finishing out of the points today.
Yep, I just want to go, thank you, Nicky, actually, a really good point about the cameras. I just want to go back to that one for a moment, if I will, as we come into the dying stages of the race. It is exceptional to be able to see these drivers in their own environment, using their own hardware, and racing against each other, and the concentration that they have got to go through. And credit where credit's due, massive thanks to AK Informatica in Italy, who have put these broadcasts and this series together to yourselves out there in the world who are watching these pictures. AK are working remotely, like we all are in the current World Health situation. They're getting all these drivers, 24 drivers in each category. They're producing the race action on track with the special Ferrari 488 Challenge Evo car. The broadcast pictures are coming into race control. They come into myself and Nicky, who are in different parts of the world as well at home, and then they're bungling it all together and broadcasting it globally for everybody in real time to enjoy. We're getting the onboard shots of the drivers too, the interviews and all that comes with it. It's a magnificent technical achievement, and much more difficult than it sounds on paper. So great credit to everybody, all the boys, girls, men and women that are involved in bringing these championships pictures to you out there in the world. Fantastic stuff, and an honour and a privilege to be working with them, with Ferrari and with Hublot for this Ferrari Hublot Esports series. Brilliant stuff, and the drivers are most certainly living up to their end of the bargain, especially this man, Gianfranco Giglioli, by producing what has been incredible racing up to this point.
Yeah, it really has been a cut above the rest. It's been an absolute pleasure to watch, you know, to watch him normally battling it out with Jarno Kocz, less so today. But, you know, he really has been one of the outstanding drivers, I think, of this competition so far.
He has, and I am reliably unreliable when it comes to mental arithmetic, but Jarno Kocz has won the first three races, so 25-25-25 gives him 75 points. Gianfranco Giglioli has had a second, and a third. Now, if Kocz stays in fifth, and Gilioli crosses the line as a race victor in just under 4 minutes' time, I think that will move Gianfranco Gilioli up to the championship lead as we bring this to a conclusion. So great stuff from Gianfranco Gilioli, doing everything he needs to do. Of course, he's qualified. He's definitely guaranteed to be going to the grand finale, guaranteed to be in with a shout of racing for that Ferrari Driver Academy eSport team position that he once held back in the day as well. But he also wants the honour. He wants the privilege. He wants the prestige of winning this championship too. And he's doing everything within his power to make that happen. As we look again at Numa Natale, he dropped 4 seconds off the bike of Tanitsa. I don't know whether Tanitsa's made a mistake or Numa Natale's dug deep into his back pocket and found some lap time, but this fight is reignited once again in the dying moments of this race. Natale tried and failed. Now he's giving it all he has got, running off the traditional racing line. There are no punctures here, so he's safe in that regard, but he is all over the back of Tanitsa, and Natale sees this as unfinished business.
Oh, what a brilliant little battle there to end the race. I mean, sadly, it's not going to be for any points, but still, don't give up until the checkered flag, because you never know what might happen. And it is just fantastic to see these drivers really, really pushing up until the last moment.
It is indeed. And somebody else who's pushing is Angela Muth. And look how sideways the car went, dropped a couple of wheels onto the dirt, manages to gather it all together again with some precocious usage of left and right steer to keep the car facing in the right direction. But he's chasing down now Marcin Swinarich and Mironovic, now in ninth position that we see ahead. So we're on board with Swinarich. Muth and dropped back after that little incident, and now we've got Swinarich, Mironovic, and Patil a little bit further ahead. So these two are very much where the action is at, heading into the last 1 minute 45 seconds on the clock. Marcin Swinarich in 10th position, Mironovic in 9th place, separated by 1, 2, maybe 3 car lengths at the absolute maximum, coming down into the final lap. This is a fight that both drivers will want to see resolved in their favour, but only one driver can come out ahead. Let's hope they manage to keep it clean in this final tour of the circuit, the Spa-Francorchamps circuit. Mironovic is the man with the advantage at this moment in time, but that can all change in a heartbeat, and Swinarich will be giving his all to close up to the back off and hopefully, in his instance, overtake the Ferrari ahead.
Oh, what a fantastic end to this series. The Pro and Am series is about to draw to a close before we head into that grand finale. And once again, a huge thank you to all of the drivers that have competed in this series so far. And it's going to be sad to say goodbye to some of them today, but it just means the competition is stepping up another level in 2 weeks' time.
Yeah, it is indeed. We will have to say goodbye to some of these drivers at the conclusion of the race, but that is motorsport. She is a cruel, cruel mistress, and only a select few can make it through. Numa Natale wants to go out with a bang, hopefully not literally in Natale's case, as he's closing down now. He's weaving left and right. He's rubbing as close as he possibly can to the back of Tanitsa's 488 Challenge. Natale in the light blue toothpaste kind of coloured car on the outside into Brussels. The corner falls away from you. That's not the right place to be. Incredibly difficult to hold it around the outside. Will he do it? He's got a little bit of space. Tanitsa closes the door back onto the racing line again for the corner with no name. The car behind Natale cannot find a way past, but Tanitsa runs wide onto the AstroTurf. That compromises him down into the double left-hand, and Natale, a few yards too far back, catches the curb. That spits him out wide for the second part of the left-hander. That gives Tanitsa some breathing space, and I think now, if Michael Tanitsa can keep it neat, can keep it clean, he's got enough real estate between himself and Numa Natale to secure this 13th position. Of course, this position pays no points. It is purely about the spirit and the fun of racing between these two. Fantastic all the way up to the death. But this man, Gianfranco Gilioli, takes the checkered flag to win the final race of the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series AM Championship. And look at his face. He is delighted. That is a dominant performance from Gianfranco Giliola. Fantastic result. He knows how much that means to him. Dominique Blegère is in second place as this fight between Natale and Tanitsa comes down to the chicane. Natale makes the same mistake again, too late on the brakes, rejoins the circuit, allows Tanitsa to recover into 13th place. But that was fantastic. Gianfranco Giliola is your race winner. Dominique Blegère in second, Roman Gole in third. Pech finishes in fourth position. Jarno Koch, first three race wins, fifth in race four. Tiskovic in sixth place. Panero in seventh. David Patil in eighth place. Ninth is Swinerick. In tenth is Mironovic. We've got Anjan Amuthan in 11th. Gregor Schill in 12th. Michael Tanitsa at the death retains 13th place. Numa Natale takes 14th, Luskovic in 15th, Stryker in 16th. After an undisclosed early incident, DeMalco rounds out our finishing positions in 17th place. And Nicky Shield, what an amazing way to end what has been an amazing championship.
Well, let's take a look at the final provisional classification for the AM Series. You can see there, Jarno Koch, unbelievable. What a finish. 87 points to his name with three first place finishes and 12 points today. Gianfranco Giglioli, 76 points. Dominic Blauer in third place. Fourth place is Monero. And fifth is Michael Roman Gnoli. Now in sixth place on 28 points, we have Leonardo Del Calmo. In seventh, Norbert Mavai. Eighth, Andrea Benedetti. And in ninth position, Thomas Skibler on 14 points. Just 2 points behind him on 12 points is Martin Swiderik. And the final two drivers that are going to be going through to the grand final in 2 weeks' time is Torben Peschke and Matthias Tytskovsk.
Yeah, some fantastic performances from our AM drivers there. Very much a fight to the death for those top 12 positions. Brilliant driving from all concerned. And now let us take a look at the final provisional classification for our pro drivers. No surprises to anybody that Arnaud Lecomte is the series champion with a perfect score of 100 points. Giovanni Di Salvo had a spirited end to the season to be second on 66. Joint scoring with Kamil Pawlowski from Poland, also with 66 points to his name. Danilo Santoro is fourth on 42, ahead of Giorgio Simeone with 28 points to his name. And Jesus Cecilia in sixth position, ahead of Kevin Ciccolari and Corrado Chiarello in eighth, with 14 points scored over the four-round series. Chris Hock is in ninth position, ahead of Alex Tirato. And the final two drivers that make it through to the finals next month are Tarek Gamel with 12 points and Cesare Penko with 9 points, that round out our top 12 finishers in an incredibly intense an incredibly tight pro series here in the Ferrari Hublot Esports Series. And with all that said and done, let's head back to the studio.
So there you have it. They are the confirmed 24 drivers that are going through to the grand finals. What an achievement for them. But I mean, Paul, we've got to say massive credit to all of the drivers that have been involved in this championship up to date. You know, massive credit for all of them that have been in the series racing over the last few weeks, but also all the drivers around the world that tried to compete, that tried to qualify. I think we had 20,000 registrations for this, which is just is mind-blowing. It's huge. So we've got to say a massive thank you to you guys for getting involved and for, you know, watching, supporting, competing. It really has been quite exceptional, hasn't
yeah,
it, Paul?
It's been mind-blowing numbers, and it's phenomenal to see how popular esport racing is becoming, how keen people have been to get involved in this yeah. championship with Ferrari on this platform and this car. And as you say, Nicky, 20,000 is an incredible number. So bravo to each and every one of the drivers that have attempted to qualify, those that have qualified and entertained us, the drivers that we've lost along the way through the knockout stages and the hot lapping. Real, real credit where credit's due to everybody. You've done fantastically, and each and every one of you can hold your head up high for a great performance and a wonderful experience as well that they can take forward into future competitions, isn't it? So amazing stuff, and it's not over yet because we've still got the grand finale on the 6th and 7th of November to look forward to. Three races that are going to separate who is the ultimate victor across the Pro and the Am, because they're coming together, aren't they, for a singular race.
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be a really exciting weekend. We do all get one weekend off, which is perfect timing because it's my birthday. So I'm going to go and celebrate my birthday. And then we're all coming back. So make sure you put it in your diary because it's the 6th and 7th of November. And we've got three races for you. We're going to be racing at Mugello, the Nordschleife, and in Monza. So it's going to be an absolutely epic grand finale with those 24 drivers. And I actually really can't wait to see, because we haven't seen the Pro against the Am yet. You know, what are they going to be like against each other head to head? So it's going to be very, very exciting and interesting to see who's crowned on top and who is crowned the winner and winning that awesome prize, of course, becoming part of the Driver Academy at Ferrari. Mega, mega prize there. Once in a lifetime opportunity. But I think that's all for now, isn't it, Paul?
I think it is. The main series is over and done. The main championship has been completed. I hope everybody's enjoyed it. Because I know, Nikki, I don't know about you, but I think it's been amazing. And to take it forward now into the grand finales is going to be another new chapter as we come to a close. So brilliant stuff.
Yeah, it's been very special for us and hopefully as equally special for you guys watching and for all the amazing drivers who've competed. Thank you so much. And we will see you on the 6th of November.